Hello, this is Austin Hetzler, the pastor of Christ the Rock Church of Elyria, Ohio. We at Christ the Rock are humbled and grateful to get to be a part of your sanctification today as you watch or listen to this sermon. But at the same time, we want to encourage you to be a member of a good local church and not to allow online sermons to replace the local church and to benefit from the life of that church and to give your spiritual gifts back to that church. Having said that, our website is www.christrockchurch.com. If you go there, you can find sermons, blogs, and other resources, as well as our location and service times. You can also listen to the sermons on Bible Thumping Wingnut, Podbean, iTunes, Google Play Music, iHeartRadio, and other podcast catchers. We also invite and encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube station. You can look it up, or you can use the link to it that's found on our website. I, along with a membership of Christ the Rock Church, sincerely pray that this sermon will be a blessing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, give us grace in this time as we seek to honor you by recognizing the work of your Son and how magnificent it is. His patience, His grace, His incredible desire to restore. On the way that He doesn't respond to anything that happens to Him in a prideful way. Even though heaven and earth both belong to Him. And He has all the rights of a king. He is still a servant. And He is still gracious to receive those who have offended Him in profound ways. I pray that you give me grace in this time as I communicate these things to your people and to those who are not yet your people. I pray for sinners to be saved and saints to be sanctified. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Most compelling drama ever told without a close second is the narrative of Jesus of Nazareth. If all you had was the beginning of that and the reality that God became man and dwelt among us, you would have achieved that status already. But then you have His immaculate perfections in His life, and then you have His death and the knowledge of what that accomplished, and then you have His resurrection, which we've been considering, and then you have ultimately the ascension to the Father. And the reclaiming of all power and all authority, no longer in a humiliated state. But within this great drama, there are many lesser dramas that are still great. And everybody has their favorites. Maybe Mary and Martha is one for you, and the distinction between the two and how they respond, and one worships and one works. My favorite, probably, and this is a subjective personal matter, is Luke 7, and you have the former prostitute there, and if you understand the language, she's not pressing into the house of the Pharisee to see Jesus, to get anything from Him at all. She has already received salvation from Him. She goes into that house of judgment merely to thank Him, and she does so, if you recall, with her tears and her hair wiping His feet. She is so overjoyed. But of all the lesser dramas, of which there are many, a strong case can be made that the most compelling of them all concerns Peter. Now, in literature in general, there are flat characters and there are round characters, and neither is better or worse. The distinction between a flat character and a round character is that one changes and the other does not. Flat, as the term may indicate, is the unchanging character. So whatever they are at the beginning of the story, they remain so all the way through. If they're a villain, they remain a villain. If they're a hero, they remain a hero. And there are many other examples there. The round character changes constantly, or at least changes in some significant way. Now, Jesus is so compelling as a character because He is so flat. What He is at the beginning, which is utterly perfect and unimpeachable in any way, and thoroughly magnificent in every way, He remains so to the very end. Peter, in contrast, is so compelling because he is so round you could roll him down the street. He is constantly in a state of change. And Peter is changing, and from the negative perspective, because he's a fickle fellow. And from the positive perspective, he's changing because Christ is always there to help him change, to aid in that sanctification, to give him the grace to continue to be conformed into the image of Jesus. And some of these changes happen in Peter gradually, and some of them happen in a short period of time with tremendous force. John chapter 21, coupled with recent events from the previous chapters, is the record of one such change in Peter. This is then the story of the unchanging one bringing yet more sanctifying change upon the ever-changing one. Our story is going to take us 2 weeks to exegete, and this week we're going to focus on Peter's special redemption. Next week we will continue that, but we will do so with emphasis then upon the fact that Peter is redeemed for a purpose, and we will examine the nature of that purpose as well when we get there. In a moment we're going to turn to the text, and when we do, we're going to see a jubilant Peter, an effervescent Peter, who's bursting at the seams because he cannot wait to be as close to Jesus as he can possibly get. And then we will see also a Jesus who is very much obliged to let Peter get as close to him as he would like. In isolation from the rest of the gospel narrative, this would be noteworthy. It would be something that we would need to learn from. That is always the right disposition, and the fact that Jesus would receive any of us at all is a profound grace. However, when you connect what's happening here to the gospel narrative and to the recent happenings with respect to the relationship between Jesus and Peter, this encounter reveals a grace in the Lord Jesus that is beyond anything that you would observe in the natural sphere. Mothers do not give their natural-born children this kind of grace. So let us make that connection so that we may understand this grace. John records Peter's betrayal, but the weight of it is felt in Luke more so than in any other account. So I'll read that to you. Luke 22, 54 through 62. Having arrested, meaning Jesus, they led him away and brought him to the house of the high priest, but Peter was following at a distance. After they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter was sitting among them. And a servant girl, seeing as he sat in the firelight and looking intently at him, said, "This man was with him too," him being Jesus. But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, another saw him and said, "You are one of them too." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." After about an hour had passed, another man began to insist, saying, "Certainly this man was also with him, for he is a Galilean too." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." Immediately, while he was still speaking, a rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. And the verb there communicates more than a passing glance. This was an intense gaze. The Lord looked at and through Peter in that moment because they were in the same vicinity. And as a result of this, Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had told him before a rooster crows today, "You will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. Peter's betrayal was heinous. Any attempt to gloss over it, any attempt to make it better than it is, really destroys grace and forgiveness that comes next. This is the worst betrayal that any person ever perpetrated against another person in the history of humanity, save only the example of Judas, which also happened against Jesus. And it's due to the fact that no one has loved anyone to perfection but Jesus. And so to betray such a one is far more evil than to betray, say, me. I never loved anybody perfectly, so if you betray my love, it cannot be as bad. In the category of the believing, no sincere believer has ever committed a greater betrayal than this. And it's not to say that we wouldn't have if we had the opportunity, but the circumstances that allowed for this are not experienced by any of us as they were for the 12. Now, Jesus is the God-man, and errors derived from excessively emphasizing one of his natures at the expense of the other nature is common. He has two natures. Both of them are very real, and both of them he truly holds. It's one of the reasons why people deny the bodily resurrection or the incarnation at all, because Jesus is so God that he could not have truly become man. Thus, he is merely manifest as a man, they will say. Or more common to our day, you have the tendency to emphasize Jesus' humanity at the expense of his deity. I am happy that the Jesus is my homeboy t-shirts seem to have gone out of vogue, that were popular around, I think, the 2010s. He's far more than your homeboy. He's the judge of the living and the dead. And so without falling into this latter error, let us acknowledge that Jesus is truly human and that his intense gaze was a truly human response. And that response was born of deep hurt and anguish because of what Peter had just done to him. Surely in that gaze between Jesus and Peter, there was some of the sorrow and grief that Isaiah foretold that Jesus would experience. Isaiah 53:3, he was despised and forsaken of men, even his own men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Sadly, the we there included those that Jesus gave his entire life to equip. And this is manifest especially in that Zechariah 13:7, they struck the shepherd and all the sheep scattered. And Jesus quoted this in the Gospels and applied it to himself with respect to what was happening with the disciples in the time when he was taken. And most notable was the way this abandonment occurred with Peter. As we enter into John 21, realize that this betrayal, which was really felt by a very much human Jesus, just happened. Perhaps days or at most weeks prior to where we are now. We do not know where we're at in the chronological progression. That isn't given to us. But in any event, this didn't happen long ago. And keep this fact in the forefront of your thinking as you consider the interaction here between the betrayer and the betrayed. Let us now with that enter the text together, and we will work our way through as we go. John 21, starting in verse 1. After these things being the appearance to Thomas that produced that great confession, "My Lord and my God," Jesus manifested himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, and he manifested himself in this way. Simon Peter and Thomas called Didymus or twin, and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will also come with you." They went out and got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. Now the very fact that these men have returned to fishing has sparked no small debate about their faithfulness to Jesus. It's even said by some that this is evidence of their apostasy, that they turned from the ministry and the life that they'd been called to and instead turned back to fishing, which was their vocation previously. In reality, this is evidence that the disciples were hungry and probably that they still needed to make money in order to live. Furthermore, they are exactly where Jesus has commanded them to be, which was Galilee. He told them to go there to wait for his next appearance to them. He told them this in Mark 14:28 and chapter 16, verse 7. Sea of Tiberias is another name for the Sea of Galilee. That's how you know where they are. And there are more names for that as well, and we'll see another one of them later. So these men then are where they are supposed to be. They are waiting for Jesus. They're trying to rustle up some food in the meantime and maybe make a little money, but they are not catching anything, which is significant because they are not weekend warrior type fishermen. This is what they did for a living. However, after a night of frustration, a gentleman appears on the shore. His identity is shrouded, so really he's a silhouette. And this is because darkness at this time of day is just giving way to the daylight. But this undiscernible someone yells some counsel to them, verses 4 and 5. "But when the day was now breaking, Jesus stood on the beach, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. So Jesus said to them, 'Children, you do not have any fish, do you?'" Now children can be likened to fellas or lads in the colloquial way in which it was spoken. It doesn't necessarily convey paternity of any kind, not spiritually or biologically. And the word used for fish conveys a very small amount. In other words, he's just asked, "Do you even have a tidbit of fish? Do you have a minnow in that boat?" It's another example, by the way, of Yahweh asking a question for the benefit of the one being questioned, not for his own benefit. He knows full well the answer. So what is the answer? Going on in verse 5, "They answered him, 'No.' And he said to them, 'Cast the net on the right-hand side of the boat, and you will find a catch.'" Now, fishermen often listen to other fishermen. If you are fishing in a given body of water and you are catching absolutely nothing and you have a gentleman who fishes there frequently and he says to you, cast your line over there, you're probably going to do what he says. You assume that he has experience in that. And if you're hungry from exerting yourself all night and you have no food, you might be inclined to hope on the advice of a confident stranger even more so. And that is exactly what they do. So going on in verse 6, they cast, and when they were not able to haul it in because of the great number of fish, therefore that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. Now this, once again, is John, as we've noted, the disciple whom Jesus loved. That reference is always a reference to John, who in humility does not want to name himself in his own writings. And that kind of quick perception is common to John. If you recall, not that long ago, he looked inside the tomb. Peter marveled when he saw the way that the linens were lying. John knew immediately that Jesus had risen from the dead, that wasn't the fruit of some grave robbery. Also, John probably realizes that this is Jesus so quickly on account of the fact that this is not actually the first time that a situation like this has occurred. Luke 5:1-11, now it happened that while the crowd was pressing around him and listening to the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, that is yet another name for the Sea of Galilee. And he saw two boats lying at the edge of the lake, but the fishermen had gotten out of them and were washing their nets. And he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little way from the land. And he sat down and began teaching the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Simon answered and said, Master, we worked hard all night and caught nothing. But I will do as you say and let down the nets. When they had done this, they enclosed a great quantity of fish, and their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat for them to come and help them, and they came and filled both of the boats, so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw that, he fell down at Jesus' feet, saying, go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. Simon Peter started to understand who that was that gave him the advice. For amazement had seized him and all his companions because of the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, do not fear. From now on you will be catching men. And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. And so that's another reason why John immediately recognizes the fingerprints of Jesus all over this situation. Now with this, you have the basic facts that lead up to the forthcoming fellowship. At this point, I want to acknowledge something with you that should be obvious. And that is that there is no doubt that Jesus has intentionally orchestrated this situation. Jesus chose when to approach them. He chose where. It is further then sensible to assume that he is also the reason why they did not catch any fish prior to his coming, to set this up. And the motivation for Jesus setting this whole situation up is also obvious. It is that they have almost graduated from the greatest seminary in the history of the world, but not yet. And there is a lesson here that was taught to them previously, but warrants teaching them again. Most recently in John 15:5, you had that lesson, apart from me, you can do nothing. Absolutely nothing, not even a little something. Not even, as it turns out, fishing successfully. That's quite literally true, actually, considering that post-resurrection, all authority had been given and really given back to Jesus in heaven and on the earth. That would include the seas. And also considering that he upholds all things by the word of his power, Hebrews 1:3, even the little fishes, as he demonstrated very clearly when he fed the thousands and manifested those fishes in his hands, pulled matter into being. A situation also creates the necessary preconditions for Peter's full restoration to ministry, which we will conclude in next week's lesson. But it begins as soon as he realizes that that silhouette on the shore wasn't some kind of commercial fisherman helping a fellow out. That silhouette belonged to Jesus. Continuing in verse 7. So when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put his outer garment on, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. But the other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards away, dragging the net full of fish. Well, notice first John's perspective as one who stayed in the boat, but the other disciple came in the little boat dragging the net full of fish. Not everybody had the luxury, as it turns out, of taking a swim and just leaving everything behind. So John was there to navigate the barely steerable boat, I'm sure. and try to get it back to shore as weighed down as it was. But those considerations are far from Peter's mind. How's he going to get back to the shore with the boat? Who cares? I just want to be with Jesus. What happens to the fish that we just got, that we had been out there all night trying to get? Who cares? I just want to be with Jesus. Wait, weren't you hungry, Peter? Who cares? I just want to be with Jesus. You're going to swim a football field distance in order to spend a few moments more than you would otherwise have with Jesus. Yeah, I am. I just want to be with Jesus. But aren't you concerned that by throwing yourself into the sea to get him, you'll look like a child? Nope. Because I just want to be with Jesus. Now, Peter is a creature of instinct and impulse by nature. And that's often gotten him into trouble, but not today. Everything about what he is doing here is exactly right. Peter, right now, in John 21, is the definition of the one who yearns for God. If King David had been in that boat, he may well have done the same. You recall when King David danced before the Lord with abandon, to the effect that one of his wives thought he looked like a fool and lost respect for him? Here are some of the words of David that currently are exemplified by Peter. Psalm 63. O God, you are my God. I shall seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. Thus I have seen you in the sanctuary to see your power and your glory, because your loving kindness is better than life. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands in your name. My soul is satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth offers praises with joyful lips. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night watches. For you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. Who's watching? What will they think of Peter? Who cares? God incarnate is 100 yards away. So I'm just going to hurl myself into the sea to get to him as fast as I can. That is the heart of worship. By the way, if you've understood Christianity to be a set of facts that a person comes to an intellectual assent to, you have misunderstood Christianity. And that error is a critical one. Now, we are physical beings in a physical world. There are many practical considerations that we need to give priority to. We have to provide for our families. We have to live here. We have responsibilities that we cannot shirk. But you can't always proceed that way. You can't in every situation have this kind of awe-filled abandon. But what a tragedy if you never do. Now, John may have in some sense regretted being left with a mountain of fish in a tiny boat. But Peter doubtless never regretted leaving the boat to be with Jesus that much sooner, just as Mary never regretted not immediately tending to the work that Martha did. Not to be a sluggard is sin, but to be jolted out of your daily rigmarole to run to your king is hardly being a sluggard. That is being a worshiper. And thus Peter's impulse to be with Jesus right now is far from rebuked. It is rewarded, rather, with sweet fellowship. Verses 9 and 10. So when they got out on the land, they saw a charcoal fire already laid and fish placed on it and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have now caught. The one who not long before this had washed their feet in service to them has now cooked them breakfast. Turns out that arisen Jesus was no less a servant than he was before that. And the fish that Jesus had supernaturally granted to them, that was bonus, layered on top of what he had already prepared for them on the fire so that their hunger might be satisfied without delay and they wouldn't have to wait to prepare that fish. Going on in verse 11, Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of large fish, 153, and although there were so many, the net was not torn. Now Peter's happy delirium at least subsides enough for him to go back to work and helping get this large volume of fish. Now, somebody obviously counted these fish, and the reason for this is either that they were selling the fish, and so they needed to calculate the profit that each man would be due, or somebody wanted to have an accurate count due to the supernatural provision so that they could relate this information later to others, for example, in John chapter 21, so that they could tell us how great, how grand this actually was in specific detail, or it's a combination of those two factors. Continuing in verse 12, Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples ventured to question him, "Who are you?" knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and the fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus was manifested to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Now, this being the third time that they had seen Jesus, at least in John's account, not in all the accounts, they knew full well who he was. We may assume then that Jesus ate with them also, as he had in Luke 24. Post-resurrection, again proving that Jesus' resurrection was physical and not merely spiritual, that he wasn't some sort of ghost manifest. And the fellowship that they had was no doubt sweet over this meal. They sit and they eat with Christ, this time knowing all that he did for them and for all the believing. This time that veil had been lifted that had characterized them during his ministry. And this fellowship would have had all the earmarks of sweet fellowship between Christians that we experience. You'd have had theological discussions woven into jokes and laughter. These were Jesus' friends. And as Jesus was truly human, fellowship meant for him what it means for you. Notice that there is no hint of separation here between Jesus and his men, any of them, for any reason. He serves them. They enjoy his company immensely. He enjoys theirs. As a critical application that remains today concerning grace and restitution from past sins inside and outside of the context of the Christian life. Before we do this, it's imperative, though, to recognize again that the whole story of Peter's reconciliation will not be told until next week. And the other half of this then will remain until then, and without it, your understanding will be woefully deficient. Let me simply say that Jesus is definitely going to circle back to Peter's great sin and Peter's betrayal. Forgiveness does not pretend away sin, and reconciliation requires that the sinfulness of sin be truly seen so that that sin may be forsaken to the glory of God, and so that the fruitfulness in the Christian life may be achieved. There is a flattening out of the issues concerning forgiveness and reconciliation and a conflation of the two, and it's very, very common. And it sends people often back into horrible relationships with other people because they don't understand the distinction, and they get ministers who won't make the distinction for them. One party may forgive another party. That does not mean that the preconditions for reconciliation have been met. Reconciliation is a process that involves both parties, the one offended and the one offending. And so you got to understand that. This is one of the great passages to understand that. So understand that we've not gotten there yet, and I hold that big caveat out until next week. Having said this, it seems to me that the best way to apply what lessons remain for today is to place ourselves into the positions of Jesus and Peter and to think through the intimacy of the fellowship that we have just seen in light of the brutality of Peter's betrayal of Jesus. That is, as I said, as recent as days old. So first, let us begin with Peter's perspective. Now, every one of us has betrayed. All of us. And those of us who are married have special experience in this. We have a greater opportunity to. Marriage is the greatest intimacy in the human experience, thus it is also the greatest opportunity for destructive betrayals. And thus we can all sympathize with betrayal from the giving side as well as the receiving. However, bear in mind once more that this betrayal is greater than that which we can commit in a very real sense, because we are not in the flesh personal friends with a man who is always kind, who is always gracious, who is always serving, who is always caring, and I mean always, never failing. The more a person loves you, and the more perfect that love is, the greater the betrayal when it occurs. And these special circumstances mean that Peter's betrayal is categorically unique in the whole human experience. Now, bearing in mind that Peter's betrayal is uniquely great, nonetheless, let us consider our lesser betrayals, that we may understand the profundity of this restored fellowship in John 21. Let me ask, When you have betrayed somebody that you love deeply in some great way, how eager are you to be in their presence, having done that to them? Are you throwing yourself into the sea, 100-yard swim, eager to be in their presence? Or are you afraid to get within 1,000 yards of them because of crushing shame and a fear that any offering of affection that you would give to them in that state would be refused by them and met with disdain? The latter, of course, is generally true. You don't want to be near the person that you've done this to. So then the question of questions is, why in the face of the greatest betrayal from one true friend to another, is Peter absolutely free of any inhibition when it comes to entering back into Christ's presence, as he inarguably is? Well, there are many answers to this, and we'll raise some of them. But the simplest answer to why he is so eager after he has committed such great evil to Jesus to be in his presence is that Peter knows Jesus. He knows him well, very well, from observed experience. Jesus is the great restorer. Repurposing discarded pieces of refuse is his constant endeavor and delight. Peter has seen Jesus save whores and make them daughters of the Most High God. And he's seen him do that a lot. Peter has seen Jesus take a thieving tax collector who was basically the scourge of humanity in his day and make him one of the 12. And that is, of course, Matthew. Peter's seen Jesus take the little children into his lap. Peter's heard Jesus call Judas friend, even as Judas was betraying him with a kiss without a hint of irony or sarcasm. And Peter even knows that Jesus suffered the indignity of death by murder and cried out during that, "Father, forgive them." Thus, Peter knows what all saints know, that to hurt the Lord we love is pain. But there is no hurt that we can render to him that can push us from his presence. And just so that we are all very clear Christians, we have all hurt him. The Holy Spirit is also the Spirit of Christ, Romans 8:9. You believers are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. Spirit of God and Spirit of Christ are the same person. His names are interchangeable. Then combine that fact with Ephesians 4:30, do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit that indwells believers is the Spirit of Christ, and do not grieve means that you can grieve. And how do you grieve him? You grieve him when you sin, and sin is, of course, a betrayal of Christ. What else would you call it when you return back to the thing that he was crucified to save you from? And we feel the effects of our betrayal as conviction of sin as true believers. It's one of the ways that we know that we are true believers. It is as though we can almost feel the Lord Jesus fix his gaze intensely upon us as we return to the things that he has saved us from. But because he has saved us from those things, we may always run back to him, and indeed we must. We too, like Peter, must run to Christ. Christ has accomplished the means of drawing us near, and it's Satan that whispers that we may not. Who is the one who accuses? Romans 8, it's the devil. Unsuccessfully, though, because we have been declared righteous. It is in the aftermath of your rebellion that you need to run to Jesus most. Learn from Peter here not to hesitate. In that space that we have created, in the fellowship that we have between God, there is much shame. And that shame grows the longer that we stay separate. And you know what else grows too? Sin. And thus it has been said, keep short accounts with God. Indeed, there are many, many Christians that have spent far too much time estranged from God in daily experience because they endeavor to carry that shame that Christ has already borne on their behalf. It's a device of the devil. Know the character of Jesus. It is beyond wonderful, it is beyond my understanding, but it is nonetheless real that irrespective of what I have done to him, I may always run back to him and he will always be willing to receive me. Do it quickly. Now then, let us consider the perspective of Jesus as the betrayal of Peter is still very much fresh for him. As we've all been betrayed, we have also Or rather, as we have all been betrayed, we have also all betrayed. And as we didn't want to be within 1,000 yards of the one that we betrayed, we don't want to be within 1,000 miles of the one who betrayed us. It is the hurt that comes from those you love that wounds you most deeply. And Jesus felt this. Again, he felt this as a true human. We also felt it as one whose conscience had never been seared. Mine has. I have calluses on my soul from the sins that I've committed. Sins in that way then are like drug abuse. The first time it affects you greatly. After a while, when you get to the point of addiction, it doesn't affect you near as much. You don't feel it that way. Jesus feels the effects of sin fully because he has never committed any. He doesn't have those calluses. He doesn't have a conscience that's seared in any way. So how was that gaze that made Peter weep bitterly so soon softened to such an extent that Peter runs to Jesus like a toddler's son to his father when his father gets home? Now the answer to that is that tetelestai, or it is finished, covered Peter's betrayal too. It has been finished with respect to this as well. You may say that what Peter did to Jesus, even though it just happened, is already as far as the east is from the west. As far as being distant from the heart of Jesus. The work of Christ is the sole means of approach to Christ and to the Father through the Spirit. Ephesians 3:8-14. To me, the very least of all saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unfathomable riches of Christ and to bring to light what is the administration of the mystery which for ages had been hidden in God who created all things, so that the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known through the church to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose which he carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord. Listen, in whom we have boldness and confident access through faith in him. Therefore, I ask you not to lose heart at my tribulations on your behalf, for they are for your glory. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father. What is the means of approach for the Christian on his best day to God? It's Christ, Christ and him crucified. And what about his worst day? Christ and him crucified. Outside of Christ, there is nothing a man may do to establish fellowship with the Father and with his Christ. But inside of Christ, there is nothing a son or daughter can do to end that fellowship with their Father or their Savior. There's nothing uglier than the kind of sin that Peter committed. But how beautiful is the soul whose ugliness has been washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. Christian, this is great encouragement to you, I hope. If you're an unbeliever, you need to look at this and understand that there is nothing in the natural experience that compares to this. You do not have a person in your life that would see everything in your soul and still accept you, much less accept you this quickly. Allow you to jump out of a boat and run to him after you'd done something this awful. And you have your own evils, friend, that you don't confess to others because you know they would turn away from you. Jesus alone will not. But the way that he does this is through faith and repentance. You have to turn to the Lord and trust him. And then, this friend that Peter had, that he could run to in his darkest hour, will be your friend as well. Trust in the righteousness of Jesus. Trust that his death paid the penalty for God's wrath for you. And trust in the power of his resurrection that you may be raised to new life. Heavenly Father, I pray that you give grace to the hearer. I pray that they would seek you even today. I pray that they would desire that sweetness from Jesus and the experience of it personally. I praise you and I thank you for all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.